Lakeland Currents, your public affairs program for North Central Minnesota. Produced by Lakeland Public Television with host Ray Gildow. Production funding for Lakeland Currents is made possible by Bemidji Regional Airport, serving the region with daily flights to Minneapolis-St. Paul International Airport. More information available at bemidjiairport.org. Closed captioning for Lakeland Currents is sponsored by Nisswa Tax Service, tax preparation for businesses and individuals. Online at nisswatax.com.
Hello again, everyone, and welcome to Lakeland Currents, where we're starting our 11th year and still sponsored and underwritten by Nisswa Tax, who has been with us through this whole period of time. Want to thank them very much. 11 years, I don't know where the time has gone. It's gone really fast. But it's great to be back on air again. And as you probably know, we shoot not only from the Brainerd studio, we also shoot from the Bemidji studio, where we do Lakeland Currents now with another host. So it's good to be back again, and I'm going to start the show this year with one of my favorite topics, which is fishing. I have Marc Bacigalupi, who is here today, who is the Area Fisheries Supervisor for the Brainerd Lakes area. And if you've been following fishing, and if you've been following climate and how things are changing, you know there's a lot of topics, a lot of issues that are being talked about in the fishing business. So we can maybe clarify some of that today when we get into the depth of some of these discussions with Marc. Marc, thanks again for coming on board. And as we were just talking a little earlier, you were first on this show when you started your job, and I can't believe it's been 7 years ago.
Yeah, time flies when you're having fun, I guess.
It's amazing that you've been on this job for 7 years. Did you have your professors at college tell you that this job could be a very controversial one? Did they ever tell you
that? Yeah, you know, we take a lot of math and statistics class, and they were just starting to get into the human dimensions. That's, I think, the word for it now, the controversy and ways of learning to work with folks on these tough issues.
What is your general area that you supervise?
Yeah, so the Brainerd area, the boundaries consist of Crow Wing County and Lower Cass. You know how Cass has mm-hmm. the two chunks of it. We have Lower Cass and Gull Lake and Sylvan are a big piece of that, and some of the creeks that run into that watershed. But also just four townships, this is an oddity, four townships up in Upper Cass, which are up towards Outing, so the Roosevelt Lake, Washburn Lake, Thunder Lake area, four townships included there, and then all of Crow Wing County. So, you know, many, many water bodies in Crow Wing County keeps us busy.
That really is a pretty large geographic area, probably bigger than people think if they haven't driven from Outing back down to here. That's a pretty good stretch of water.
Yeah.
And a lot of that is part of the Leech Lake area watershed, is it not? You know.
Correct. Pine River is a big chunk. Pine River watershed is a big chunk of our area. We have the Mississippi drainage there, and also the Crow Wing River has a big chunk of our area too. And the Leech Lake watershed is, you know, north of us a little bit, but it's all largely feeds into the Mississippi River, which comes right through our alleyway here.
Well, could you just tell our viewers in general, what do fisheries people do? How do you spend your typical year? What is it that you're working on?
Yeah, well, the backbone of our information system relies on lake surveys. So in the spring and summer, when open water period, we can get our hands on a lot of fish through our netting techniques. And that is the way we gain our information to formulate our management plans, our strategies through regulations or stocking, or working with folks on special project habitat projects to get the things done that we can do to make fishing as good as it can be on a given water body. So we have hundreds of management plans in folders, you know, that we try and get to as much as we can. And some of the bigger high profile lakes get a little more attention than some of the smaller lakes, and they get we don't get to those smaller lakes as often, but you know, there's 400 water bodies to get to, really more like 100 of them that we have management plans where we're trying to implement strategies. So there's always plenty to do in the summer. So we're gathering as much information as we can in the summer. In the winter, we're writing those reports, thinking about proposals, planning a budget, and trying to competitively grab little chunks of funding out there that we can do, that we can grab to get some of these little projects done. And that, and so, and then in the spring, a big project is the of course the Pine River walleye trap. Brainerd area is one of the cornerstone areas for walleye production in the state, and so we're getting the raw material walleye eggs for some of the walleye production that goes on statewide.
I know that there's been a lot of research being looked at now in the areas where we have invasive species, and I think one of the misconceptions that a lot of people have is that Minnesota is pretty well overwhelmed with invasive species, but in fact it's only about 5% of our lakes, I believe, that have been identified with aquatic invasive species issues. The rest of them are still pretty pristine and pretty healthy. Isn't that the case?
That is the case in terms of number. Minnesota is blessed with so many water bodies. You know, it's always the land of 10,000 lakes. It's something more like 11,000 or 12,000. But yeah, percentage-wise, the number of infested lakes isn't that high. People have argued that the lakes that are infested are large in terms of acreage, and that is true. And because that they are popular water bodies, not just in terms of boating and recreation and fishing that goes on, but also in terms of lake users or property owners. And that is another avenue where these critters can get into our lake systems.
I know I've fished a lot of the area lakes for most of my life. And I know Gull Lake has got zebra mussels. Pelican Lake's got zebra mussels. North Long Lake has zebra mussels. Velagers were discovered last fall in Leech Lake. And we know that Mille Lacs has zebra mussels. And I always am kind of amazed at the critics of the DNR who so often are not scientists, but they're probably a lot of times people like me who spend time in the water. Mm-hmm. And that is such a complex environment down there underneath that water that mm-hmm. it's really hard to get a handle on what's going on, isn't it? I mean, I'm in my view, of course, these zebra mussels clear up the water because mm-hmm. they filter so much water. Are you starting to look at how is that changing the culture of the environment under there in terms of how are fish behaving?
It's a huge area where a lot of research could be going on. And we are, DNR works with academic institutions and with MAZARC on some of these very projects. And these have started and are getting underway. They're starting to look at food webs. If the dynamics of the food webs are changing with zebra mussels. And you mentioned the clearing water. I think that's one of the major issues with zebra mussels is the fact that they, not so much that it's changing the energy flow, but the clearing water is really gonna be something that affects what people are seeing out there. Plants will grow in deeper areas. It could affect the way the lake warms. So the water temperature regimes out there. So fish are gonna do different things in clearer water than what they were doing before. And it's not all it's very difficult to predict mm-hmm. what's gonna happen.
And I think it's good for people to know that the research that you folks do on the lakes is available on your website. So if you wanna look at what are the creel surveys showing, for example, on Gull Lake, how many fish you're stocking in the area, that information's all available to the public. How do they get to that?
Yep, you know, the Google search engine is good. Within our website, you have a search abilities, and like you say, all our information available. I think that's one of the strengths of doing this public work with an agency. You know, just the good old fashioned telephone call to the info line will get you to the researcher or the fisheries biologist that you're looking for to ask those questions, and they make themselves available. Sometimes it takes a couple days to get that phone tag down, but it's all out there.
I know in the last 3 or 4 years there's a lot of criticism that Gull Lake doesn't have the walleyes in it anymore that it used to have, and I think the last 2 years has proven that most of the people who said that were wrong, because those walleyes were there and they're beautiful fish, 18, 19. Last year, there were a lot of 19-inch fish that came out of that lake. It seems to me that they are spending more time in the summer into the vegetation, maybe, than they used to. And it used to be like we could go in the middle of August, the end of August, and find a lot of walleyes in 12 to 14 feet of water. With that cleaner, clearer water, I shouldn't say cleaner, but clearer water, They seem to be moving deeper a little earlier, and they're in different spots. So it must be just about impossible to tell people exactly how they're behaving down there with this changing environment, isn't it?
Yeah, and we never could before. You know, we would know where they are in relation to our nets. You as a fisherman probably always had a better handle of what they were doing. But, you know, this is a recurring thing throughout the state. You can go through the newspapers and find several examples of, you know, our netting statistics are saying one thing and fishermen are seeing and thinking another. And it's just that, you know, fishing adds information, it does, but it isn't as reliable as our netting in some ways, because our nets can catch fish that fishermen are not catching. That's really the gist of it, because our nets are very effective, and they're effective by design, because we have to get our hands on as many fish as we can in a short period of time to do the survey work around the state fairly efficiently. So there's always those conflicting pieces of information, but creel information is really important, and it's what a creel is basically just getting angler information of how long they fished and what their catch rates were and what they kept. So angler and harvest rate information is expensive to come by, and it's just chronically underfunded, and it's just one of the challenges we face, because that is the bottom line, is what people are catching and how satisfied they're going to be with their angling trip. That is the bottom line, but we're also looking at what the baseline populations are out there to create the conditions that can produce good fishing at times.
Maybe you could talk just a little bit about, and I don't mean to focus just on the lakes and Brainerd here, but you are going to do some research on smaller fish in Gull Lake. And the thing that it's been amazing to me is the last 2 years I've caught jumbo perch on Gull Lake, 12 and 13 inch perch. And I can't remember catching as many as we have been the last few years. It seems like that perch population's pretty mm-hmm. healthy, and that's one of the areas you're going to do some research, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's showing some promise. There, traditionally, we've looked at perch, our standard nets catch perch that are larger, 5.5 inches and bigger. And those fish are already sexually mature, so we're not, we're just getting a snapshot of a segment of the population. I think we're a little bit blinded to what a really important part of the perch population is, are the young of the year, the age ones, age twos. These are small fish under 4 inches. And we really don't have a good feel for what those abundances are and how they can be affecting fishing. The obvious thing is that when there's a lot of them out there, the fishing can be slower.
Sure.
But that is overall a good thing, and it's basically the foundation of a walleye fishery, is having a good perch forage base. So that's something we're just starting on, and it's a little project in the Brainerd area. Maybe it'll expand and be something that other areas can do, and will, you know, like anything, the more types of lakes you can study and have similar types of studies on, the better your information is. So we're really on the starting line there. But there's a larger issue statewide, is that there is kind of a trend in lower perch numbers in our standard nets, and that's a concern because of their importance in the food chain. Mm-hmm.
I know the Leech Lake numbers were down probably the most since the 30s, in talking with Doug Schultz last year, that the numbers are coming up on Winnie, which is good to see, and the size is coming back a little bit. But so that'll be interesting to see what that research shows.
You mentioned kind of the cycle on Gull Lake. Research does shows that these perch populations cycle a little bit, but overall they're cycling down in a lot of cases, mm-hmm. and we want to
figure out why.
Figure out what we can. Yeah.
Yeah. How big a staff do you have for the service area that you have to take care of?
Yeah, I have a staff of 6. We're probably a little better staff than average. Brainerd is such a popular area with large number of water bodies, but it's a little bit just about through attrition. If right now in our agency, if somebody leaves, we're not filling that position very quickly to gain what we can through salary savings. And so some areas have started with an office of 5 or 4, and if they have a vacancy there, they're down to 3, you know,
wow.
in some cases. And
that's a lot of geographic area to cover with.
Yep, you break the state up into 28 area fisheries offices. Brainerd is one of them. you know, you do the math on, is it 87 counties divided by 28, and so each area office has two or three or four counties to cover. And so that's, with the water-rich area we have, that's tough for three or four or five people.
Let's just talk a little bit about walleye stocking and then maybe muskie stocking. I read that recently there's been a reevaluation of how stocking is being done across Minnesota, mm-hmm. because you're finding that some areas where you're stocking, it hasn't been very effective. Mm-hmm. Could you just talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's all related together. We're talking about budgets and staff and efficiencies. We have to be, you know, efficient government is a good thing. We have to be as efficient as we can all the time. So we go back to these baseline surveys and how they're the key information pieces in our decision making. So if these surveys are showing that over 10, 15, 20 years that increased stocking levels haven't been resulting in higher catch rates, then we really have to question if that's worth the money. Fingerlings are very expensive. If we're just to go to a private grower and buy them, they're $18 to $20 a pound, and that's about $1 per walleye. And a lake, a stocking rate for a lake would be a pound of fish per literal acre. So some bigger lakes have 1,000 literal acres. 1,000 pounds of fish need to go in there. That's $20,000. That's pretty expensive. So, or no, $200,000.
Oh,
so
wow.
It's pretty expensive.
Very.
Yeah.
And then you also started stocking muskies last year in Gull Lake. And you've stocked some, I think, the year before in Roosevelt, up in, by Outing.
Yep.
Could you just talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Roosevelt Lake started, we got a new, Roosevelt Lake as a new muskie lake in 2011. It started.
Oh, was that long ago?
Yep. And it does take 8 to 10 years to get a muskie fishery going, to have enough larger, mature individuals where it's worth it to go over there and fish. Roosevelt Lake's just starting to come on now as a place where people can go and see a few fish, get some follows, get some mid 40-inch fish, and I've heard good reports of, you know, people having a good time. It's worth their while to go over there right now. So that's 7-8 years into the game there. Gull Lake was just started as a muskie fishery, and that was in the news quite a bit, I'm sure, as people are aware. Just started in 2016. And so it'll be, 7, 8, 9 years until people are going to start showing up and fishing for these muskies that are going to start to get into the 40-inch range. Now, we were electrofishing this fall. This was interesting. We did catch a muskie that's from 2016 in Gull Lake in September, and it was 20 inches long.
So oh, my gosh.
It was that was impressive growth rate, because they go in as 11 inchers typically.
So it almost doubled its length in 1 year.
So it's a good sign for the conditions are good for some of the muskies that are
now in. Will you stock any more muskies in Gull Lake?
It's on an every other year stocking
every
plan.
Other year.
That's in our management plan. It's a strategy that's shown to have worked and be relatively efficient. Statewide and in the 40 other some stock muskie lakes.
It's amazing to me how emotional of an issue that is, especially to lakeshore owners who feel that muskies are going to wipe out the walleye populations. I can remember a couple of other lakes that have been stocked over the years, and it never seemed to be the issue that people thought it was. And I think Gull still has a pretty good Cisco base, doesn't it?
It's a good Cisco base in Gull. It fits all the biological characteristics with it. We have a really good track record of tracking the 40 some musky lakes that we've introduced muskies, and we've really seen that the fisheries are not hurt by that. You've added a musky fishery, but you really haven't taken away from the other species, and that's because the musky is such a low density predator. There's only one every 3 or 4 or 5 acres.
Wow.
And so, you know, they have a large presence when it shows up, but ecologically, it's not taking up a lot of space.
Well, what are some of the new initiatives that you got going on?
Well, we always have a lot of things going on in the Brainerd area. One of the things I'm pretty excited about is that we were able to get 4 new aquatic management areas this year. You mentioned I've been here 7 years. We hadn't had any in the first 7 years, and then, you know how things go, just things happen to go right and we have four new ones in the air, that opens up a little piece of state land. It's like a wildlife management area. The first goal of an aquatic management area is to protect nearshore habitat, and they're geared towards lake frontage. So you're protecting lake frontage in an undisturbed way. But it's also, if you have a 30 or 40 plus acre piece of land that someone could go sit in a bow stand and or hike or cross country ski in the winter.
It always has some water on it, I would assume.
Yeah, the aquatic management areas are geared towards either a river or a creek or a lake. Yeah.
Okay, so you have four of those, and are they all in Crow Wing County, or?
They're spread around. There was one up in the northern part of Crow Wing County into Cass. There's one in the center, and then one over towards Pelican Lake. It's, you know, like I said, it's just kind of been how the cookies fell this time around. But we're happy to be trying to add opportunities in the Brainerd area for different recreation for folks to come here and visit and have a good time. You know, on that vein, one of the things that has gotten positive reviews is opening up winter trout fishing opportunity in the Cuyuna Country State Recreation Area. That's been a hit. You know, the mountain bikers have been really going over there and, mm-hmm. and doing that. And some people have been really finding a good combination of fishing and mountain biking when they come to visit this area. And winter fishing, which was closed for many years for trout,
right.
for trout or any fishing on the mine pits, is now opened. So you've got to be careful on that ice, because those deep water lakes have thinner ice than your other typical lakes. But once that ice formation is good and the trout season is in play, you can fish for all species on, you know, there happen to be some large northern pike in those, some of those mine.
What are the kinds of trout that you're targeting there that people would be targeting?
Well, we're mostly stocking rainbow trout in these systems, and it's a put and take system.
Sure.
You know, it's a very popular thing after in open water in May for people to do. And but we're also getting sometimes we get some surplus production, put a few extra fish in there for the winter fishery. There are some brook trout available to people. And there's one pit even that has lake trout, and that's really popular in the winter because those lakers don't seem to necessarily bite in the summer, but they will bite in the winter.
Okay. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah.
It's similar to Trout Lake.
Yeah,
we find
right.
Trout Lake isn't real good in the summer, but they do definitely bite in the wintertime.
That's right.
Yeah.
It's so trout fishing in the Cuyuna Country State has been really popular. We've had positive reviews. Probably sold some trout stamps that way too.
So when you look at the area lakes like in the Brainerd area, Pelican, North Long, Gull Lake, do you see the fishing is still about what it's been historically when you're doing your netting, when you go in and do mm-hmm. your survey? Are those lakes pretty well holding true to what the historic levels have been?
Yeah, you know, Pelican has been one where it's been on the downside a little bit. We're working really hard on Pelican to get it back to where it's been, and we're working really hard with the Lake Association cooperatively. But, you know, looking at long-term trends, whitefish chain is as good as it's ever been.
It is.
Gull, you know, while the numbers are down, the fishing has been good, and we're working on gull really hard. North Long has been really good fishing, so we haven't heard complaints over there, and the population looks strong. So yeah, the big lakes in the Brainerd area are doing pretty well, and we're watching them as close as ever, knowing that it's a big draw to the area.
You know, we're talking about climate change, and there's no question that climate is changing here. The water temperatures this year were pretty normal, though, weren't they? We didn't get that. It seemed like if you went from Minneapolis south, it was really hot. This area seemed to stay, I think we only had 4 or 5 days in the 90s. Water temperatures didn't get too bad, did they?
Yeah, the water temps were low. I think water clarity ends up being pretty high because of that. It does. It doesn't seem like there's a normal year anymore weather-wise.
Really?
So it's really hard to remember what normal used to be anymore.
Yeah.
But yeah, it certainly affects fishing. It's been a little bit of an odd, you know, in and out year for fishing, but
now do you
the populations are there.
Do you still have hearing sessions during the course of the year? in the area for just getting input from people.
Yeah,
you still do that?
Yeah, I mean, I like to say every day is a public input meeting for me because you can people call and email at all times, and that's fine. That's a good way, and it's a good way to ask for information. Really keeping the open lines of communications with associations and the civic groups is really an important thing. Recently, we had a public meeting for Moody Lake to open that up to catch and release fishing, which is it was in the paper as just a tiny little blurb. But that's one of the examples that I was trying to mention about opening up some opportunities. That lake was closed to fishing. It was kind of an experimental lake within the Moody Lake Aquatic Management Area. So that public input has been so far positive.
I just think that is a great idea to have catch and release lakes, like Hubert for bass. Someone like me, I can take grandkids over there who want to learn how to fish, or people who don't really come from the area and don't want to keep fish. It's so nice to have a lake like that where you can go in and the populations are good and you can catch and release them, and that's a great thing. It really is.
The power, the value of recycling these fish, you know, catching and releasing and someone else having an opportunity to catch again, has really been it's been a powerful thing that people have opened their eyes to, with bass fishermen leading the way with the catch and release ethic. Musky fishermen are really doing that now, where even a legal fish over 54 inches that they could keep there, they want to see go back in the water for someone else to catch. And that's something we need to see, because there's more and more people out there. There's not going to be less. And so the slice of the pie is going to be thinner for everyone if we want to, you know, we can't grow, we can't have more, in a large sense, we can't have more than our carrying capacity of fish. So it's just going to be dividing the pie up a little bit.
Everybody wants more fish, but they don't realize that you have to have a biomass to support all that.
Yeah.
Great. Well, thanks for being on the show. Appreciate it very
much. Thanks for having me again, Ray.
You've been watching Lakeland Currents, where we're talking about what you're talking about. I'm Ray Gildow. So long until next time.